Hope. Okay, so hope I am audible to everyone, and I actually hope everyone is doing good, especially these current times, and I hope your family members and everyone is good right now. And thanks a lot to SRM, Dr. Kavi Shankar, every prestigious HODs and faculties for inviting me to be a part of this program. I will try to do justice and will provide my learnings over a period of years, which I learned through industry. And as a basic, to let everyone know what blockchain is and how we can benefit it and how what could be the career opportunities. Okay, so thanks. I'm sharing my screen. Please let me know if you're all able to see my screen. Hello. Hope my screen is visible to everyone.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Sorry. And I always highly recommend that if in case anyone have any questions in the meanwhile, please raise your questions in the chat box. I will try to cover those questions and I will try to answer as well. So let's let this session as an interactive session where you also clear your doubts and get to know as much as possible. Okay, so let's start with blockchain. So I will go a bit back. I will take a step back. So like every day, every month, every year, we are coming with this, some kind of new advancement in the technology. And across the world, there are a lot of research work and a lot of invention of new technologies are happening over a period of time, because over a period of time, we are realizing every day the new kind of problem is coming to us in front of us. And at the same time, we are trying to solve that problem. So after a lot of, you can say the first invention was internet, and blockchain is called the second best invention after the internet itself. So that's, blockchain is that huge in this industry right now. And let me tell you why it is called the second best investment, second best invention after the internet itself. And it's a huge tag which is given to blockchain. The reason it started actually in the 2008 last. I will start from the very, from where the blockchain started and how this came into the industry. So it actually started in 2008 last December somewhere, where we still don't know. There is a person called Satoshi Nakamoto, whether they are sir, a money, person
sorry, or an individual. Sir, yeah. Money. Sir, could you please increase your volume a bit, sir?
Just give me a second. Let me take the AP. Just give me a second.
Okay, sir.
Just give me a second. I'm taking the earphone actually.
Sure, sir. Sure, sir.
Am I audible loud and clear now?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Great. Okay. So what I was starting with, the blockchain, how it came in the industry first. So it actually started in the year of 2008. It's late 2008 in November, December. We still don't know whether this is group or any individual name as Satoshi Nakamoto. And they wrote a white paper actually in 2008. The white paper was all about this Mr. Satoshi Nakamoto wanted to create a another way of currency or another way of cryptocurrency transactions. and he is basically a founder of Bitcoin. And what he did that he wanted to remove the interdependencies on the mediators in any normal money transaction. For example, in normal fiat currency transactions, we are dependent on banks, we are dependent on a lot of third-party agencies in between, and they charge their fees in between, and it's a and this process we have to depend upon some government agencies as well. So Mr. Satoshi Nakamoto said that why we, it's my money and I'm sending my money to another person, why I have should be depending on any other person or any intermediary. It's simple as that. It's like cash, you have cash in your pocket, you just hand it over your cash to someone else. There is no interdependency in between. So with that concept, what he said, it's like we in the current digital world, we can adopt a digital currency which is not dependent on any third party in between. It was, that was the kind of vision he has. And he wanted to develop one digital currency and wanted to bring that digital currency in the world. But he, while bringing the digital currency in the world, he came across a lot of challenges. The first very challenge is that, let's say he developed some digital currency. First of all, why people will believe on his digital currency? Because we believe in our currency, normal currency, because it is backed by the federal agencies of the governments in every country. But this digital currency will not be backed by or not cannot be controlled by government agencies. So first of all, why public will believe on that currency? That was a big question. Second, since we are calling it a currency, then there are chances of increasing fraud is also very, very high. So it creates a lack of trust among the people. He realized that it might create a lack of trust. Why people will ultimately trust on this currency? Because it's quite possible they think that this is another kind of fraud which is happening, and why they will consider this as a currency. So this is second. Third, he wanted to safeguard this currency from any kind of malpractices or any kind of malicious activities or frauds in the complete ecosystem. So considering all these factors, he realized that the digital currency he wants to bring to the world, that should be self-autonomous and that should be self-controlled without having intervention by someone else, outsiders. Okay, so people should be trusting on the system rather than trusting on any agency or any people. So with that concept, what he said, that the first big thing, like the digital currency which I will be bringing in the market or in the world, that will work on the distributed ledger technology. So just to give you all a gist, what is distributed ledger technology? So he said that he adopted this term basically from the banking industry, where I'm sure you all might have heard the term ledger, where every entry is getting done into the files in a very audit trail model and with a complete time stamping. If you remember the before computerized banking system, there was a ledger system bank used to follow. Okay, now with the same concept, he said that we'll follow the distributed ledger technology, where the data will be stored into the database in a very, very chronological order and audit trail format. However, it will be a distributed in nature. So distributed ledger technology means, unlike our traditional technology where we work on a centralized or decentralized model, where we follow master-slave servers, centralized server kind of way, because in traditional world, the traditional technology, if we are dependent upon any centralized server or decentralized server, ultimately it is controlled by some agency, some company, some people, some person who has the admin rights of that server and can make changes from the backend. But he wants this system to be complete self-autonomous. That's why he wanted to give more power to the system than the users. To the people involved in that. So what he said that this overall network, this blockchain network will be in the form of distributed ledger technology, where there will be multiple servers. And the best part is that every server will have the exact replica of same copy of database. So if 10 transactions are happening in that application, all those transaction, 10 transactions will be stored on each server. If let's say it has 10 server, then every 10 server will have the exact same copy. Okay, and he adopted a democracy in here. He said that every server will be equivalent. There is no master and slave concept in this particular whole server ecosystem. Okay, now the second concept he said, but still it don't fulfill, it don't secure the completely. So what he said that the coding and the transactions, rules and algorithm, which will be stored into this distributed ledger technology servers or nodes, that should be stored in the form of smart contract. So he said that he adopted this term from the legal contract. So in our traditional world, what we do when we go in the business or some kind of transaction with some other person or organization, we first of all, we sign the agreement. We sign some legal agreement, then our business happens according to that legal agreement. But in our traditional legal agreement is more of a reactive. Why? He said that's more of a reactive because in order to put that contract in force, something already is, it means already happened. After that, only that legal agreement, you go to the court of law and fight a case. It is a very, very huge time taking process. The first of all, second, redressal and everything is very time consuming, money consuming, and it's taking a lot of time. Instead, what he said that in my sense, we are talking digital here. So we will predefine the algorithm and be right in the form of smart meter ledger technology. So going forward, any transaction, if it satisfies the of the smart contract deployed on the servers, then only the transaction will be completed. If any kind of breach in the agreement, transaction will not be complete in the first place. So it's a more of a proactive model rather than a reactive model in our traditional, like our traditional world. Okay. Then the third thing is said that now we created a distributed ledger technology, the bunch of servers connected to each other and has the exact replica of information database, and which is controlled, every transaction on that ecosystem is controlled via a smart contract. But since he said that he wanted to adopt the democracy in this whole ecosystem, blockchain ecosystem, he said that the every server, just consider, just assume a democracy. In democracy, every person has the same rights. He said that every distributed ledger technology, every server will have the same rights. They should participate. Every server should participate in this whole blockchain network in giving their verdict whether the transaction which are happening in any application is happening as per the smart contract algorithm agreement or not. Because he said quite possible some people hacked some server. But if the majority servers are not hacked, then the malicious activity will not be possible in the whole blockchain network. Okay. So what he said that he created a consensus framework. So in order to pass, every server has to reach out to some level of consensus. So minimum 51% and above server has to be in the favor of the transaction complete. Then only the transaction will be completed, else transaction will be failed. So you can understand by giving this democratic rights to these servers, he made it complete automated, the complete autonomous, self-autonomous. It don't require any kind of third party in between. And whatever the agreements is deployed over the smart in the form of smart contract over the distributed ledger technology, they are working without relying on any outsiders. They are taking a better decisions. And not only that, they are stopping the malicious activity to happen in this whole network. Okay. And the best part is that, just give me a second. Yeah. Yeah. So the best part about it is that, he said that once the data is entered into the blockchain network, it cannot be edited afterwards. Okay, so that's the beauty of the blockchain. For example, unlike our traditional databases where you enter the data, but you delete it, you can delete the data from the backend if you have admin rights and etc. But in the blockchain, once the data is entered, it's completely immutable. It cannot be altered. It cannot be deleted at all, not even by the administrator of the system, not even by the owner of the organizations. Okay, so that's the best part of the blockchain. It's complete immutable, makes it that once the data is entered, it's completely audit trail will be there forever. It can be audited, it can be checked in the form of chronological order. Okay, so that's why it is called a single source of truth. So this, the whole server becomes a single source of truth, and the cryptography, the every data which is getting transaction which is happening in the form of SHA-256 cryptography, and which is a military grade cryptography. So which makes it extremely secure. This system technology extremely secure, and since there are multiple distributed ledger servers are involved in it. It might be easy for hacking one or two servers, but let's say if someone has a 10, 20 servers, hacking more than 51% server is very, very difficult, and it's make it almost impossible for anyone to make it server. So when this Satoshi Nakamoto published this white paper, and then he developed the Bitcoin ecosystem and bring the Bitcoin in the market, it actually attracted the eyes of the investors and the various organizations. They really wanted to know the underlying technology of the Bitcoin. See, Bitcoin is one use case. Try to understand, Bitcoin is one use case digital currency, but it attracted the eyes of the major investors, organizations, institutes, and educational institutes that what is this underlying technology of the Bitcoin? The same technology can be adopted and can be implemented in different parts of organization. For example, in supply chain, you just remove Bitcoin as a use case, you put the supply chain as a use case, you put as a some ERP as a use case. So they really intrigued to know about this technology, and they started investing in this area by making it more and more autonomous, because they realized that the biggest deficit in the world, what is the biggest deficit in the world, is the trust. Although we are very well connected today, we have a very well secure internet connections everywhere, even in the villages to the cities, but we are still prone to kind of frauds. We don't trust each other. That's the biggest deficit currently in the world. So what if we bring some system where we don't need to trust, people don't need to trust any other people, they just only need to trust on the system. If the system is secure enough, they don't need to worry about the trust factor. It's the system which will take care, enforces the contract, enforces the agreement deployed in the form of smart contract. So that's actually became the key for this whole blockchain system and the blockchain network, okay? So now coming to the blockchain, when Mr. Satoshi Nakamoto published and developed the Bitcoin, from then onwards, it attracted a lot of eyes across the world. And the best part about the blockchain, investors actually started investing millions and billions of dollars behind this technology for developing new and new use cases every day. Hello. Okay. So point is that now you see the power of this blockchain, and I'm sure you start realizing why it is called the second best invention of the internet, because this blockchain systems are actually making you think secure. It's creating a trust on the system. And at the same time, it is the way we are moving towards the automation. Everything is getting automated right nowadays. So more and more we are getting dependent upon the internet and technology. We need the robust and secure technology where we can trust upon, which cannot be hacked, and tomorrow malicious activity cannot be performed. So blockchain became one of the key answers for making everything more and more secure in our daily life. Okay, so that's why it is called the second best invention. And what is within a blockchain? So within a blockchain, the most important thing is the database, which is stored in the distributed ledger form. A list of record transaction like a ledger that keeps going as more entries are added. Okay, well, these are the key components of any blockchain, which is distributed. Copies of the entire database are stored on multiple computers, on networks, syncing within minutes per seconds. Okay, it's transparent. Records stored in the database may be made visible to relevant stakeholders without risk of alteration, because if you remember, as I said, once the data is entered, it cannot be altered, it cannot be deleted. Only thing you can update it, but it will create its footprint. It will create its complete chronological order, who changed it, when he changed it. So even you will have the previous version available, the new version available as well. Okay, it's highly secure. So malicious actors, hacker can no longer just attack one computer and change any records. So in order to compromise the system, they have to hack more than 51% of involved, you can say, the servers. Okay, and it's immutable. The mathematical algorithm make it impossible to change, delete any data once recorded and accepted. Okay, so this is what a key components of any blockchain ecosystem. Now, if you see the centralized, what is the basic difference between centralized, decentralized, and distributed ledger? So if you can see in our traditional technologies, the centralized and decentralized concept we use. For example, if let's take example of WhatsApp, we all use WhatsApp. So WhatsApp, every application has majorly the two things, front end and the back end. So the front end, the UI, which is installed on your mobile devices, which you can feel, you can see, and from where you interact. Okay, the backend is basically, let's say you have sent some message to some other person, the message don't directly reach to that particular person. In our traditional world, what happens, it reaches to some nearest servers, or maybe some in where in the decentralized in the geography, it reaches to that server. From there, it ping to the ultimate senders. That's the kind of cycle it follows. Okay. And in distributed ledgers, it's a peer-to-peer. That's the difference. It's complete peer-to-peer, and every server. And in our traditional servers system, it's not necessary every server holds all the records, the exact replica of everything. Quite possible some server might have different kind of information, other server have my different kind of server, third, fourth server have some kind different kind of servers. But in distributed ledger server, it's different. Every servers are connected, directly connected to each other without interfering any between. And every servers, every node has the exact replica, exact copy of everything. So even you add tomorrow new server in the blockchain ecosystem, before performing as a node in that ecosystem, in that network, first it will update itself based on the transaction happened till that time. Then only that server will be able to participate in the validating the new transactions in the whole network system. So how exactly the blockchain works, if you see that in our current payment processing, there will be link, there will be some centralized bodies, and from where the payment get again distributed to others. Whereas in the cryptocurrencies network, it's a very simple wallet to wallet transaction. I have my Bitcoin wallet, you have your Bitcoin wallet. I transfer my Bitcoin from my wallet to your Bitcoin, your wallet. Not like our banking system where the money is actually stored in the bank and I'm sending request to bank to transfer the money, and then they are transferring money to some other person. Okay. It's a very simple human to human interaction which is happening. Okay. And how usually things happen in the blockchain network. Let's say you are working on any blockchain application and some A and two person, A and B, are interacting, or A is sending one Bitcoin to B. How the journey starts usually? So A will log in into wallet, or new, he will initiate the transaction, and which then broadcasted on all the nodes. Bitcoin, let's say Bitcoin has around 10,000 nodes across the world. Okay. So it will be first broadcasted on all the 10,000 nodes. Then each nodes collect new transaction into a block. So first, what all nodes will do in the public blockchain concept, they will start fighting to each other. So basically what happened, that node will first hover around all the nodes available into the ecosystem. And then every node, especially in the public blockchain, not in private blockchain, in public blockchain, I will come to that, these are different kind of blockchain as well. Just a second. Yeah, so what happened? Then transaction is hovering around all the nodes in the blockchain network. And then every node start fighting to each other to become a miner. Okay, so the miner is the entity who first validate the transaction, the first person, the first node who first validate the transaction. And miner only exists in public blockchain, not in private and consortium. So in public blockchain, the miner first is the entity
But in order to become the miner, how you some server can become the miner? So every transaction will come accompanied with some kind of mathematical problem, and every server, every computer involved, first try to solve that mathematical problem first. Whomsoever solve the mathematical problem first, that get a chance to become the miner first. Okay. So in Bitcoin, let's say some miner, some node solve the mathematical problem first, and it solved and becomes the miner. Then what it will do? It will first analyze what kind of transaction is happening, and it will analyze that transaction and compare it with the smart contract deployed in that node. So you see that every smart contracts are deployed in all the nodes. Same smart contracts are deployed in all the nodes. It will compare with the smart contract, that particular smart contract, and if that miner found that valid transaction, it will immediately sign the transaction and gives the verdict to rest of the nodes that this transaction is valid. But still transaction is not completed. Even the miner given the validation, again, on other, let's say there are 100 nodes, other 99 nodes will again validate the transaction deployed against the smart contract deployed on their server system. Then they will give the voting and consensus, and the majority gives the voting. Yes, the validation given by the miner is right, and we can complete this, pass this transaction. So the moment this completed, then only the transaction gets completed and the crypto Bitcoin get transferred to other person. So that's why you will see in Bitcoin network, it still takes 14 to 18 minutes to complete one transaction. Bitcoin was built on older infra. That's why it takes much time, but the new blockchain networks which are coming, they are very, really high in speed, and they are working really exactly very good in this space, okay? So each node collects a new transaction into a block. They collect the information in the form of a block and attach a block to the previous block. Okay, so let's say the transaction is continually happening in the chronological order or timestamping order. Every transaction gets connected to the previous transaction, what happened. So that you can create a story out of it, you can audit everything. So how complete audit trail is created. So that's why when the block is connected to the previous block, it's called the blockchain. Okay, so each node works on finding a difficult proof of work, which is called mining. When a node finds a proof of work, it broadcasts block to all nodes. Then nodes accept the block entry to or transaction in and valid are not already spent, and node express their acceptance of the blocks. Okay, then after every node's given the go ahead, or more than 51% of nodes given the go ahead, then blocks gets added to the previous block, get attached to the previous block. Okay, then the block, that's why hence the word called blockchain, because every blocks are connected to each other and every blocks contains the transaction information. Okay, now what is smart contract? A smart contract is basically a piece of code, the smart contract, an event driven program deployed to shared replicated ledger, which can maintain its own state, control its own assets, and which responds to the arrival of external information or receipts of asset. Okay, so if you can see transaction events, whatever transaction and events which are happening, everything get controlled with the help of smart contract. So while developing the blockchain application, what does it mean by developing blockchain development? Blockchain development means majority of the time smart contract development. So you actually write a code, convert the agreements and condition in the form of contract. So every blockchain network uses its own proprietary technology. For example, Ethereum is one of the blockchain network. It uses Solidity as its proprietary technology for a smart contract development. That's a language which they use. And when you deploy over Ethereum blockchain network, that smart contract get deployed on all the nodes. For your information, right now, Ethereum has around 33,000 nodes across the world, okay? So when you develop any new smart contract or application over Ethereum, when you deploy over Ethereum, Ethereum blockchain, it is basically getting deployed on all 33,000 servers, okay? So you can see it's a more of a proactive approach. Smart contract is a more of a proactive approach for controlling what is happening over the blockchain network. And it should only perform what is meant to be performed. So that's why it is very important, okay? Then what are the key benefits, important points? So in public blockchain, it is available for anyone to access. So available for anyone to access means that any one of you can create your own server, become a node and server, or participate in the any blockchain network, any public blockchain network. So you can deploy the codes, you can become a miner, but it doesn't mean you would be able to view, read, and everything, understand all the transactions which are happening. Okay, so every transaction gets stored in the form of hash. You will only be able to see the hash. Okay, so hash is a kind of hashing technique which stores the transaction information in the form of hash, which you won't be able to understand what exactly that information is. Okay, but you can participate as a miner of any of these public blockchain. Data can be added but cannot be altered. Add data validators, miner have to verify the transaction. Okay, that only new transaction can be completed if any miners verify and other nodes verify the transaction. The transaction has to be approved by a majority in the network. No central authority has control over the information. And best part is that privacy is protected by cryptography. Okay, that hashing technique comes from that cryptography. So now you see the biggest deficit in the world is getting solved with the help of the blockchain network. We are encouraging, blockchain is encouraging people. You don't need to trust each other. You just trust on the system, then everything will be just fine. Okay, so that is really, really important in nature. Okay. So we already talked about this in 2008 when a group of Satoshi Nakamoto they introduced the Bitcoin, and we all saw, we all are seeing the current the Bitcoin value, the acceptance of the Bitcoin. Even we all know that there is no regulator of Bitcoin, there is no regulation body of Bitcoin, but still we trust with our fiat currency, with our money on Bitcoin. And we trust that no one can do the fraud with us over from this currency, okay? But more than Bitcoin, as I again say, industry organization, they are more interested in its application, the underlying technology of Bitcoin, okay? So from that till that time, thousands and millions of applications has been developed over various blockchain networks or blockchain technologies. Hello. Okay. So you can see now what is the blockchain tipping point? It's really important to understand. So it is assumed by 2023 tax collection by government with the blockchain will be start utilizing in that area. It's anticipated by 23 trillions of IoT licenses connected to the internet. See, the more and more devices are getting connected to the internet, it's creating more and more frauds. It's create an environment for more and more different kind of frauds, which can be controlled with the help of blockchain. So imagine your IoT devices are connected and controlled with the help of blockchain-based applications. Then you are making it a more secure environment for all the people. Digital transformation outreach 80% of the population, that's the huge. By 2025, P2P economic maturity is expected to reach 26 smart city fully operational. And blockchain is key to any kind of smart city operational thing. And by 27, it has been said that 10% of the world's GDP will be on the blockchain technology. And trust me, it's huge. And it means that it's already by that time, it will be a main part of our daily life. And in fact, in current time also, we are seeing that a lot of technology, blockchain buzz already started happening. So of course, the question is no longer whether blockchain will disrupt the business, but how fast and far, and we wanted to make sure our business is up to speed, like early we want to adopt this technology and we want to learn about this technology. Because this blockchain is actually there to make a difference, make a way people works and make a change the way people works in there. Okay. So there are various adoption happen in the blockchain. This is a bit old data, but just to tell you, majority industry which they started developing some kind of use cases using blockchain technologies are banking and capital markets. Governments, in India, Hyderabad, Andhra Pradesh, and Telangana, I believe they are the first one to announce that they will be implementing blockchain technology in their land records, land registry records, to store the land records, because one of the major fraud area in India is the land related frauds, and the majority litigations in the government is land related. So after that, following Hyderabad and Telangana, a lot of other states like Haryana, Uttar Pradesh, West Bengal, Maharashtra, they all announced to implement block some other use cases. Even the Election Commission of India already started, passed a huge budget to implement blockchain in their voting section, to capture the voting by giving a proper rights to the to citizens. Okay, and how the digital blockchain can be implemented in the voting as well. So you can see that there are a lot of initiatives already happening. Educational department, the education ministry, already working in the area where to minimize the duplicate, to minimize the fake degrees. What they are trying to work on, that they are trying to work on some kind of initiative where they can develop some blockchain-based application and make mandate to a majority of the universities or different colleges to first enroll with them and publish the degree on that blockchain-based network. So tomorrow, if someone wants to validate someone's degree, they can just directly go to their centralized application and validate that. If degree is there, then only the degree will be acceptable as a right, or that can be considered as fake. So that kind of initiatives are which are already happening. Okay, and in various agriculture in the in some of the countries in across the world, they have implemented for supply chain, for a supply chain of the food products, they started implementing the blockchain. Okay, so there are a lot of sectors which are getting benefited out of it. Blockchain adoption across the globe, you can see the corporate registration, land registration, entitlement management, identity management, digital currency payments, governance, healthcare, interdepartment process optimization, voting. These are the few key examples which are already implemented. These examples which I'm taking, it's not like it's under R&D. It's actually already implemented at various places. Okay. So, in fact, if you see that in USA, one county organized the voting, digital voting over the blockchain-based voting system as well. So you see that we are pretty in advanced stage and we are reaching to the next level. So what are the usable types of blockchain? And so the till now, the what we were talking about was the concept of a public blockchain. So always remember, if the cryptocurrencies are involved in any blockchain network, for example, Ethereum, it has the Ether coins, Ripple coin, every blockchain has its own network, okay? If the cryptocurrencies are involved, it's called public blockchain. It's just as we understand, this is a public blockchain. And public blockchain means anyone from the public can participate and can create its own node and create and can participate as a node, make their system as a node and become a miner in that application. Whereas there is other two kinds of blockchain are also available, consortium and private. So after the Bitcoin success, when industry started doing research and development, they realized Bitcoin digital currency is one thing, but when we are going adopting as an enterprise application, when we are implementing application in enterprise, they actually don't need cryptocurrency as a part of that. They just need a power of a blockchain. So they removed the cryptocurrency and they said, for example, the Maruti is one of the automobile company. If they want to control their 1,000 vendors, they need application rather than a cryptocurrency there. So what if they can implement a blockchain-based application for better controlling their vendors in their supply chain, for example? So considering all these factors, the researchers, they come up with the two different kind of blockchain systems called consortium blockchain and private blockchain. So what is consortium blockchain? Consortium blockchain is the blockchain where, let's say, some set of entities, predefined entities, for example, in USA, around 35 entities, which has 28 banks and several validators and some companies came together, formed the consortium and said that they will develop the KYC application. Right now, what happened in the banks? let's say you applied for a loan at State Bank of India, and let's say what the first process they will do, they will perform a KYC process on you. And after KYC, then they will tell you whether they would be able to give you the loan or not. So it takes time. And after 2 days, you realize that they inform you that they won't be able to give you a loan. Then you approach to the Punjab National Bank, and again, they will perform the same KYC from the scratch. So it is a hassle for the banks because they have to invest huge amount of money into running in this KYC, for example, KYC department on the people, process, and everything. And at the same time, it's hassle for the customer, like why he need to go again, same process again for the different banks. So to counter this kind of problem, then US, these 35 entities came together and developed the KYC application using blockchain consortium, blockchain application called Corda. Okay. And so in Corda, what they did that these all 35 entities is participant part of this one KYC application. And they encouraged users to upload their documents, KYC documents in there, and where validators pre-validate the KYC application details. It's the matter of time when the customer goes to, like, for example, SBI, they just given the access, just give see my data. The SBI can take the decision in a matter of seconds rather than depending upon huge KYC application, other things, okay, processes. So that is one example of consortium where multiple entities are coming together, forming a consortium and creating one application. So that's what is happening. And the private blockchain, it's a private blockchain, is fully private blockchain to some, where some organization implement that private blockchain for their organizational benefits. For example, Maruti is implementing supply chain application or integrating their blockchain-based application with their ERP to manage their vendor more efficiently across, let's say they have thousands of vendors. The more and more vendors, the more and more complexity is there. So they implement, but this initial implementation of this supply chain application is happening for benefit of the Maruti, right? So that is called private to Maruti, okay? So, there's another blockchain technology called Hyperledger, which can be usually implemented in private blockchain network, and various use cases gets created out of these technologies. Okay. Sorry. So let's say you are evaluating. We will never say that you have to implement blockchain everywhere. You should not be implementing blockchain everywhere. So existing traditional technologies are equally good, but it's not necessary you have to replace them. Just we always recommend that add a flavor on top of existing applications or analyze your use cases better, whether you really need the blockchain or not. So what these are the few prerequisites. If these you fulfill these conditions, your use cases can fulfill these conditions, just go for the blockchain. So what are these prerequisites? If in your use case, multiple parties are sharing data, multiple parties need a common view of the information at the hand. If there are multiple parties are updating the data at the same time, multiple participants take action that change the data which needs to be recorded. There is a need of requirement for verification. Participant needs to trust that action that are recorded are valid. Transaction interact, transaction generated by different participants interact with each other. Interactions are time sensitive and intermediaries add complexity. There are a lot of intermediaries. So if these six conditions are met, feel free to go for the blockchain implementation. And so analyze, when you analyze your use cases, identify if it is fulfilling these six or if these six conditions, then go for the blockchain implementation in your use cases. Okay, so by following these six prerequisites, we analyze any use cases, whether the blockchain is really needed there or not. So framework for blockchain use case evaluation. After you identify blockchain, what needs to be done, how use case selection framework should work, is just extension of this previous slide. Is there a compelling business case to reduce intermediaries? If you don't want to reduce too much of intermediaries, don't use blockchain. Your traditional system is completely working fine. And are multiple or stakeholders involved? You just follow this path. Are you working with a digital asset instead of physical assets? do you have a like a tokenomics model if you want to adapt for a token as well? Okay, so this is more of a private blockchain, when to adopt for a private blockchain. And can you couple digital asset with physical asset with permanent and authenticated record of proof? Do multiple parties require share right access? Do you require high performance rapid transaction? So basically, based on these framework, we analyze that how, for which use cases we should be going for a blockchain implementation. Okay, so for example, I'm sure recently you must have heard that Amitabh Bachchan and Salman Khan has gone for the NFT, non-fungible token. Non-fungible token is nothing but it's a different kind of currency, cryptocurrency, digital currency basically. It's more associated with any kind of artistic arts. So basically it creates a value of art. Some of his poster or some of his art, which can be bought and sold in the form of its token only. Okay, so let's say today's value is this, tomorrow is art is getting auctioned and getting sold, so premium can be paid who already pre-buyer bought the NFT non-fungible token. But every NFT has some unique value and some unique arts value there. Okay, so you can see in India also it's huge. People started adopting cryptocurrency, started thinking blockchain, even the general public started investing in the blockchain cryptocurrencies as well. So slowly and in fact, I will say the very fast pace, awareness is getting increased about the blockchain and its technology and its related to its application. Okay. Okay. So, and the best part about the blockchain is the business continuity. So let's say there are 10 servers, even in the private blockchain, let's say there are 5 servers, even your 4 servers are down, even your 1 server is working, your business will continue working, it will not stop. But in our traditional world, even if your server is down, your complete business gets down, okay? For example, you can see that in UK, UK's RTGS payment system that went offline for 10 hours in 2014, and they do the £277 billion of transaction every day. So imagine what kind of losses they must have faced because their servers were down for 10 hours. But in blockchain, if your even one server is working, your system will never be down. It will continue working no matter what. Okay. So blockchain growth. You can see that 2015 is called actually the exploration and investment, where the initial capability and use case assessment started happening, early adoption likely for internal reconnect. See, in 2008, 2009, Bitcoin came, and 5 years took to understand, analyze this technology. In 2015, it got serious where the investors started investing behind this technology. Okay, and 2016-17, it's called early adoption, where some of the leading edge banks, some organization started developing some level of POCs for a proof of concept. And 2018-24 period, this period is going on, this growth period for blockchain, where many applications are in productions now, not only for the banks, even for other government agencies and for other manufacturing, other object organizations as well, or NGOs. They all are developing some kind of use cases. And that's why it is called 2018-24, the period of growth. And by 25, it is assumed that it will reach to the maturity, that majority of the organizations will start developing their blockchain application very often. Okay. So that's the kind of blockchain growth we are anticipating in the market. So why blockchain is needed? Now, after seeing all these, the background, can see we are in our operational currently operation, we are very much fraud prone, we are very much dependent upon third parties, we are very much dependent upon people, so which actually increases the cost, the operating cost of the complete operations. Okay, for example, in the example of KYC, we are dependent upon the complete KYC department, still it is inefficient. And every bank, every organization needs to spend millions and billions of rupees or dollars to just run that department. you can understand by putting these kind of self-automated applications, you can reduce the cost. You can completely make automated this the whole process. You can make automated. Okay, speed can be increased. Now you can see that earlier the KYC by human, it used to take 2, 3, 4, 5 days. Now it can happen in the matter of fractions of milliseconds or seconds. Okay, and settlements through immediate distribution can be done. Security is increased the most because of the blockchain as nature. You can see that you can make this automated system more and more secure. Fraud can be reduced as you are decreasing dependency on the third intermediaries. You are able to manage them with more transparency, and every entries are timestamped, is stored in the form of timestamping, and ultimately reduce risk. So the overall, this blockchain help companies, organizations, and governments and everyone to reduce the risk to make it more well efficient automated systems. Okay. So blockchain is a single, this a digital value, single source of truth, and distributed data set at each node peer-to-peer, cryptography encryption, consensus framework, it's the programmable smart contract, and permissionless versus permission can be created, okay? So I'm quickly going through from here. So you can see in public blockchain, it's viewable to all parties, and even in private blockchain, who are the key stakeholders, they all can track each other. They can see the complete information. Transactions are permanent when stored is there. Publicly available creates durability in public blockchain. Decentralized, since it is decentralized, distributed ledger technology, no central authority. Consortium of parties, data is public and easily accessible. Minimal threat from hackers. It is giving more power to users. So rather than any organization or any entity, it is more power in the hand of users because of its democracy in nature, okay? Quick transaction and low cost. You can get rid of one department and use that department in more creative work. And the majority of the work can be automated with the help of blockchain. No intermediaries, database are completely reliable. It's timely, chronological, sequential, transaction audit maintained, immutable transaction, identity not revealed of parties, reliable for both the parties, high availability and resilience against single node failure. So you can see there are numerous benefits which blockchain is bringing to the table and which is solving a lot of problems of our traditional technologies incapable of solving, okay? So that's one of the few reasons why blockchain is considered, as I said, one of the biggest invention, okay? So there are various sectors. These are the few examples in healthcare, digitized health record, trust network, pharma supply chain can be implemented, applications can be implemented. BFSI, low cost transaction, crypto payment gateways are already in the process. Government, low processing time, connected department, trust network, low corruption risk. You see that if government start utilizing these kind of applications, the corruptions can be tackled in such a way. If it's a very simple, like if you are fulfilling all the conditions, you will be getting the benefits, public benefits, what you should be getting. Okay, provenance of education records in education sector, no faulty records and certificates can be controlled. That what is getting, who has, in one of the survey that in India around 40% doctors has the fake certificates in India. Okay, so you can imagine that the level of frauds and level of provenance, need of provenance is there in the market. Okay, supply chain, single record policy, no counterfeiting can be controlled. Real estate, you can reduce more paper-based errors. So it's more digital-based adoption you can do. Transparency, confidence and trust you can increase. Okay, so in Belgium government is working with some agencies to implement the notary applications. Notary application means what they are doing, they are identify around eight or 10 odd use cases where they have developed the notarized agreements. And let's say there's a rent agreement, you just went to that application, downloaded it, the two parties, the person, the owner and the rent tenant, they just do the digital sign and the agreement get enforced. It's as simple and the agreement get enforced use cases, which is getting, they want to use in a very real time, which is deployed over the Hyperledger-based blockchain application, okay? So You can imagine this. This is now a true which is happening across the world now. So what are the key industry problem blockchain is actually solving? Is the transparency the biggest problem in the current industry? Sorry. Even in current computerized era, still there are lack of transparency. Data is fragmented. The data is too much fragmented everywhere. There's no, someone has a different kind of data. People are misusing the data. That can be controlled. Timely access to data. Even we do have a data, but we cannot access the data in timely, which delays things. System interoperability. Systems are interconnected. They are connected to each other. They need authenticity to connect to work with each other. Data security is digitizing data security of transaction. Generated data. You can imagine the trillions of devices if connected to the internet, how much data they may be generating. The sensors must be generating humongous amount of data. So that when the humongous amount of data is getting generated, you need more security layer. You need to control your mobile, your home automation. You want to control, no one can hack, so that no one can hack your system. Okay, in US, there was a case that nowadays the pacemaker which comes, basically that can be controlled with the help of Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. Somebody hacked someone pacemakers. Okay, that so more and more we are dependent upon devices, internet-based devices. We need more layer of security, access and data inconsistency. Okay, so basically it's with the help of smart contract, you can create a consistent rule-based data. Okay, cost effectiveness, ultimately you can bring more and more automation in the whole process in order to, and in the secure manner. So the more automation you are bringing in the process, and by guaranteeing the security, you are actually saving the cost for the organization and the people. Okay, so what are the most popular blockchain implementation or blockchain tools or what networks are available? I will say in public blockchain, Ethereum is one of the most widely used from the application implementation point of view. Okay, it's a generic blockchain. It's governed by Ethereum developers. Mode of operation, permissionless, public or private, consensus based, work on proof of work and ledger level. Smart contract are developed by using Solidity language, and it has its proprietary currency, Ether, and you can develop your own tokens on top of Ethers in the Ethereum. You can develop your, like, for example, I can develop my Manish token and over the, by following ERC-720 protocols. There are thousands of tokens already developed over Ether. Okay, then in private blockchain, but this blockchain can also be used in consortium. It's a Hyperledger fabric. It's modular blockchain platform governed by Linux Foundation and consensus broad understanding. Now you remove the mining. There is no concept of mining in consortium in private blockchain. Okay, so every server act immediately. They go get into the consensus framework to give their verdict whether a transaction which is happening over the blockchain network is as per the smart contract or not. So smart contract development code is used Golang and Java, which is used to develop the smart contract in Hyperledger. It has no currency. And then the third consortium specifically for the financial industries is Corda. It's a specialized distributed ledger platform for financial industry developed by R3, permission private, and specific understanding of consensus. And the language which is used to develop smart contract on Corda is Kotlin, Java, and these are the two technology which is used. No currency is involved in this blockchain as well. Okay, so what are the status of blockchain in India in 2018-19? It's state earned more than $200 million in 2 years back from the blockchain practice. Today it's in billions. Okay, ICICI Bank announced that it has onboarded more than 250 corporates on a blockchain platform for domestic and international trade finance. Okay, so they already developed the application and onboarded around 250 corporates for giving them invoice financing, for trade financing, and different kind of financing products. Okay, so in India only, the loan related fraud totaling around 61,260 crores over the last financial year up to March 2017. You can see this whole money can be controlled, more money can be saved if there was a blockchain-based application, because most of the frauds are human-dependent. some human did the fraud and the whole system pays the price for that. Okay, so that can be controlled with the help of blockchain based application. So in the blockchain trends in India, its infrastructures are growing, monetary status are very high, the lot of investment is behind. The best part is that it has a cross-sector acceptance, not only financial industry. Majority of the industries are accepting blockchain as a solution. Okay, data privacy and data security is one of the key attractive points of the blockchain. Okay, so economic potential of blockchain, as per McKinsey, what they say, it's a go into the public sector, technology, media, and telecom, financial services. Okay, there are a lot of different industries they are using the blockchain in their area. Okay, so basically, I'm just quickly going through, since this is a basic. So ultimately, what's our goal? Our goal is to create more automated system by reducing dependency on the people and removing the corruption in between and the fraud and increasing the trust. So imagine automation using the smart contract, traceability of all historical transactions, speed and efficiency of transaction by eliminating intermediaries. Okay. Distributed ledger, increasing the transparency, provides a comprehensive picture. Okay. All stakeholders see the same information to which they have access, availability of multiple copies of the shared data, reinventing products and process, transparent and predefined rules which facilitate creation of new products. Tokenization, digital assets which are physical objects with a unique digital representation that enable digital ownership, management, and transfer. Okay, so there are a lot of business features. These are the few use cases are already getting developed. In financial institution, international payments, even Visa, MasterCard, payment gateways, they are already adopting blockchain application for international payment settlement, capital market, trade finance, regulatory compliance and audit, any anti-money laundering and know your customer, which is going over a blockchain, insurance sector, peer-to-peer transaction. Corporates are using supply chain management, healthcare, real estate, media and energy. Governments are using record management, identity management, voting, taxes, government and non-profit transparency, legislation compliance and regulatory oversight. Cross-industry, financial management and accounting, shareholder voting, record management, cybersecurity, big data, store. Data storage, Internet of Things. These are the several use cases which are happening across the world now. Okay. What are the major technologies getting used? We should be learning. It's like Python, Golang, Java, C Sharp, Solidity, Web3.js, and blockchain components. It's peer to peer messaging, consensus algorithm, smart contract development. Okay. And see, this is more of a backend. Front end will be the same technology which is getting used. Angular, React, other web development framework, which gets integrated with these backend systems. Okay. And if you are developing over Ethereum, Infura APIs are used for development. Okay. So for API services as well. So what are the typical development approach? So the typical development approach, first you, of course, you do the need analysis and solution pre-selection. And then you do the impact assessment. What will the impact of, you develop in the form of POC for an application. Then you do the POC development, okay? And then you run the POC for several time. And if it gives you the valuable feedback outcome, you go for a big bang implementation. That's a simple approach for the blockchain implementation, okay? So that's the kind of the overall the blockchain ecosystem at a very, very high level in nutshell. And there are a lot of career opportunities in the blockchain. The major career opportunities in the blockchain industries and the companies are looking for the SMEs. SMEs basically those who have a functional knowledge of the processes and everything. So while understanding about blockchain, they usually play the functional architect play role, business consultant role, to suggest what kind of blockchain solution can go over in there. So they are working, and there's a very high paid jobs as well in the market. So mostly PhD research scholars, they work as a business consultant to basically they help industries in developing various use cases, various application implementation, what kind of solution can be implemented in that use cases. Then the second kind of role is the technical technology architect. The people who knows the blockchain implementation by heart and coding and everything, they basically from the infra side and the technology deployment side, they develop the technical architect. So basically blockchain architects are called, they are called blockchain architects. They help organization creating a technical solution based on the functional approach. Okay, they closely work with the blockchain for business consultant and develop the complete technology solution. Okay, then there's a blockchain developers. So every technology has its different kind of blockchain developers. Quite possible one blockchain developer know multiple blockchain applications or blockchain technologies. So these are the people who actually develops the smart contract. Okay, blockchain infra person, admin, administrator. These guys know how to manage the blockchain infrastructure, what kind of infrastructure needs to be maintained. Okay, and business analyst, business consultant, so those who understand the requirement, they work with the client very closely, and they work with business consultant and writing the complete solution end to end of the blockchain solutions. Okay, and of course the smart contract tester, the blockchain testers, they are a specialized tester, those who basically test the smart contract and the applications in there. Okay, and they try to do different kind of testing and perform the activities. So these are a few key high roles which are widely used and play, like people use. And so as I said, blockchain, it's already been old now. I will not say it's no and not a new technology anymore. It's the point where now we are at a point where organizations are started adopting and developing the application. And India is the head epicenter of IT across the world. So we are the first one to develop these kind of resources in our country. We need more and more resources to perform these tasks and activities. So job market is going to be increased for the blockchain, not only job market, even the entrepreneur, you will see that lot of people are coming with a lot of new products, startups, blockchain-based startups, and lot of entrepreneurs are coming in this sector as well. So yes, it's a booming area and it's a very interesting area with the new technology. And it's my suggestion that everyone should explore this area. And the best part about the blockchain, it can be easily integrated with our traditional technology and other tools. AI ML can automatically be placed on top of blockchain-based systems. RPA can also be easily placed. Yeah, it can be easily integrated with your traditional ERPs. So the kind of flexibility blockchain has, it's huge actually. So sky is the limit. And every day some new use cases are getting developed over blockchain system. So that's at a high level the basics of a blockchain, which I really wanted to talk about in this session. And hope you all understood the basics and the opportunities and the power of a blockchain. And with this, I really want to finish my session. Any question, please feel free to ask.
I don't want to.
Hello. 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 Kavi Shankar ji.
Yes, sir. Sir is not there. I'm LA, sir. Participants, okay. If you have any doubt, you please. You can raise the question by unmute your mic, or you can type in chat box. I'll enable chat box. Yeah, the chat box is enabled now. You can type your question in chat box, or you can unmute your mic.
The blockchain software will be implemented to all over the industries in a couple of years.
So I will answer this question like this. Almost every industry are exploring the blockchain implementation in some of their sectors. Okay. So yes, the answer is in a way, yes. Almost you will find some use cases in almost every. Be it media, be it manufacturing, be it finance, healthcare, pharmaceuticals, life sciences, and any sector. In fact, implemented will be implemented in coming years. I will say it's already implemented in many years, in many industries. Okay. For example, sorry, the government in institutions, I already talked about. There are a lot of government initiatives already been taken here. Financial banking already implemented a lot of KYC, collateral management solutions. Trade finance and insurance sectors already implemented it. Healthcare, they already implemented the pharma supply chain and records management. And educational institutes, it's already in the process of implementing. NGOs are implementing for proper giving the transparency, the money which you are donating is actually giving, reaching to the last person for whom you have paid the money. So yeah, almost every manufacturing automobile sector, Volkswagen and a lot of companies already implemented some use cases in their supply chain. Agriculture industry, they are started implementing blockchain, especially very recently World Bank has funded more than $1 billion for Vietnam to implement Hyperledger blockchain for their cold chain. So basically to track end-to-end for agriculture products. Okay, so USA already a lot of agricultural initiative related initiative has been taken in the blockchain for better transparency, end-to-end transparency of the product or of the food items. Yeah, so these are the various in, so I will say we can safely say today that almost every industry already implemented some use cases. It's already there. We don't have to wait now anymore.
Okay.
So one question from Priya. IoT devices are low memory devices where blockchain consumed for each other. How can more technology get into? See, Priya, I'm not saying IoT data will be stored on the IoT devices. IoT basically generates the data. You have to understand IoT devices generates the data. And you control, and I'm sure you were aware that IoT devices gets controlled with some kind of IoT platform. You need a platform to control your IoT devices. For example, if your home automation, either sensors are behind your tube light, you want to switch off or switch on, you need some application to switch on and switch off. That data is getting stored in somewhere in your traditional databases. That data don't get stored in IoT devices. So instead, by replacing the traditional technology, it can be a blockchain-based application through which you can control the IoT devices. So all the data which are getting generated from IoT devices are getting stored in our traditional database. Okay. Yeah. Any more questions?
Participants, if you have any questions, please ask.
What to be learned from data for data security? Okay, so see, there are plenty of programs and you can go for a cyber security. Cyber security is very niche area today and it's really important sector, Priya. There are a lot of certification programs happen in cyber security. Learn to about GDPR, learn to about HIPAA compliances, what data security compliances are there. So these HIPAA compliances, GDPR, some cybersecurity related certification that you should go for if you really want to learn about data security.
Okay, I'll add it to the.
Thank you very much, sir. You have given very detailed informative sessions. I have given the basics of blockchain technologies. Use case evolutions, blockchain growth, the need of blockchain benefits, POC approach, various examples of blockchain technology implementations. You have given a very clear, informative session. Thank you so much on behalf of IIT, on behalf of School of Computing, SRM, IST. We thank you, sir. Thank you, participants, for joining the session one. The afternoon session will be start by 2:00. You please join using the same link. Afternoon, we plan to discuss user interface design, Spring Boot development of for blockchain technology. So the user interface front end design will be explained by Dr. Russo, Dr. Russo from Vibro Digital. The session will start by 2:00. Thank you, participants, for joining. Once again, and thank Sir Manish Shukla, sir, for giving such a informative session. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks. Take care. Bye.
Thank you, sir. Bye, sir. Participants, you can leave now.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Chat box, sorry, feedback is given in chat box. If you want, I can paste it once again. The link for feedback, you please fill it.
Pero, ¿qué pasa? ¿Qué pasa? ¿Qué pasa? ¿Qué pasa? ¿Qué pasa?